the drummer's at.
Getting to know everyone here, so thank y'all for being here. It's awesome.
Yeah, no, we're looking forward. We have a half day today, so we're gonna go wander Rome together with our moms.
Yeah, we're gonna hold hands and just, you know, skip along the streets and just
be outland.
Sing again. Go
sing
ahead.
It. That's sing why it. I don't spin this fucking thing.
Don't worry, we'll make sure we'll get a spin in for Drake before we finish.
Yeah, I'm gonna hit the special box again, and it's a full furry costume this time. Somebody has it.
Brilliant over there. Amazing. I think we have a question over here, actually. Hi.
Hey.
What's up?
So I have a question. How did it feel coming into something as long-running and established as Supernatural? And was there anything you were particularly stressed about or scared of?
Not at all. No, it was a breeze. I was really stressed about working with some of the castmates.
As you should be.
Well, goddamn.
Well, damn.
Yeah, I think it's a tremendous responsibility. I feel like I say this all the time, but I was a huge fan of the show, so getting to join was like, it was no small undertaking, and Jensen made sure to make that very clear to us when we got the show. But I think a lot of responsibility.
Especially for you. I mean, like, playing John Winchester, that's a very big undertaking and a very big responsibility to have on your shoulders. So for me, it was kind of a little more... not as stressful because maybe the stress of like introducing a new character that hoping people would gravitate towards and like, and you know, being worthy of being part of the canon and serving really great to the story. So the thing that was so helpful though that I think we both felt was that we were very supported by like everyone that came before us, like Misha, Jared, Jensen. Everyone has been nothing but so kind and so supportive of us joining and coming into this show. So it's fantastic, like, supporting and honoring us and helping us be a part of Supernatural and the Mothership, but also at the same time, like, helping us carve our own path and creating our own story in a way. So it's been really cool and really exciting. So, yeah, that's what I'd say. Thanks so much. much.
You've obviously met up with Jared and Jensen and perhaps other people to have for some advice. And I just wonder what's the best advice you've been given and anything you can share. It's probably more for Drake, but Jojo, were they talking to you about it as well? I'd be interested to hear.
Well, I can say that I definitely had some conversations with Jensen, and I know that probably the relationship with Drake is just different because, you know, your dad, you know, your dad. Yeah, sure.
Nobody moved on that. Come on!
You see, you had to ask for it. I didn't. The best piece of advice I was actually able to get from Jensen, and it's because, like, this was one of my first TV things that I've ever been a part of, so I was terrified, not to mention my first day of filming was Jensen's first day watching, and it was terrifying. I look like I'm all cool and calm and collected, but on the inside I was, like, screaming, terrified. But Jensen that day, right before I started filming, it was also my first time meeting him in person. Before that, it was all, like, you had gotten to meet him in person before that, because, you know, he was in LA and I was not, I was in New York. I was of the core four, everyone else is in LA, I'm in New York City. So that day, it's so simple, but one of the best pieces of advice was just have fun. Literally, because Supernatural and all these other shows that Jensen's been a part of, like, he just has fun. He has a great time. And it shouldn't feel like work. And after that, after the pilot experience, it literally didn't feel like work any day. It felt like coming to, you know, having a day on this set, you know, with a bunch of idiots, funny idiots. It was fantastic. So it's quite simple, but just have fun. That's the best thing.
Yeah, for myself, Jensen's given a lot of advice. Actually, I call him more than he would like. And I ask for advice on everything. If it's agents, if it's business related, if it's acting related, he's a really great sounding board. So I could give you a thousand things that he's told me that I will always cherish, but there's one moment that will forever, like, I'll forever cherish. This is before we got picked up. We didn't know. We just finished the pilot. And it's nighttime, and the area is not a super safe area in New Orleans, so there's, like, police everywhere. And I remember we had one scene left, and I was sitting in a cast chair, and Jensen came up behind and just tapped me on the shoulder. He's like, hey, come with me real quick. And I was like, all right. Sure. And he pulled me around the back of a tent and set out two glasses and poured some Winchester whiskey, was the brand of it. And he was like, just drink this. And so we did a little cheers and he made a little toast, and then we just walked. And we walked down this road, and I remember it like it was yesterday. And there's just red light. Actually, Meg took a photo, and I have it. I'll post it on my story so you have a little context. It's really blurry, but we're walking towards this police car, and there's just red and blue lights flashing, and we're just walking, and we weren't saying anything, and he just looked at me, and he's like, enjoy this. He's like, just take a minute, enjoy.
I seriously thought you were going to say, you're about to be arrested.
this is for you.
You're going to get
this. This is for the fucking mask prank you pulled, you piece of shit. Get upset. Yeah, and he told me that, and he's like, enjoy it. And we turned around and we looked at just everything and what it takes to make one scene happen. It's like 200 crew members and a bunch of semi-talented actors.
Oh, God.
Carry on. And wayward son.
That was cheap.
It was cheap, but I tried. Sorry.
But yeah, we just turned around and he was like, he's like, never let the moment, don't ever lose the moment, don't ever lose this, like, this is what it's about, and everything else that comes with this, and everything that will come with this, just always remember that, like, just remember this, remember the enjoyment of doing it, and then he walked away into the metaphorical sunset, and I walked the other way and started crying, because I was like, my fucking childhood hero just gave me a, like, hey, this is your show, and that was, you know, the thing that he had toasted with the whiskey was, he's like, you're carrying the Winchester. He's like, your last name is John Winchester. He's like, you're carrying this.
No pressure.
And I think he fucking said that as he's pouring me a double shot. And I still have a scene left. Yeah, so he's, we all fucking know, he's a great guy. And he's been nothing short of a mentor, and dare I say, a friend to us.
Aww.
he's not bad to look at, you know.
Oh, he's just saying that.
We're all here, we know it.
We all know. No, he's really the best.
Yeah,
he's that's a beautiful story. That really is gorgeous. Yeah, he's fantastic. Yeah, there's nothing else you can say really about him. There's not a bad bone in his body. He has nothing but the best intentions for us and really is so great. He's literally like, I know you're dad, but he's also like dad to us on set. Like, he really looks out for us and makes sure that
I'd say more like a brother, you know?
Like a twin.
Like, we just look so similar. Yeah. All the time. Benson.
That's a reach. No, I'm just kidding. No, yeah, he's the best. That's plain and simple. Yeah.
Thank you.
Of course, Cecily, thank you.
Do you do pranks on set? I'm kidding. you know, Supernatural is such a big show, so we have an entire fandom already with inside jokes like the pranks on set question that gets asked every time. So I was wondering, were you scared to like join the fandom? Were you kind of aware of our little family fights? What were you told about the fandom?
Absolutely nothing. they have a tendency to just throw us into these things and be like, hey.
They kind of do, yeah. I remember even when we went to our first convention in Dallas, we were just handed the mics, and then they were just like, we heard music just start playing, and they just went, go. And we were like, okay, we didn't even know what the crowd looked like. We didn't even know what the stage looked like. We just came backstage, arrived like maybe, well, you were there before, but Meg and I had just arrived like 5 minutes before. And they were just like, all right, have fun, go out there. But honestly, the fandom, every time like I've interacted with the fandom, it's been nothing but so lovely and gracious and so kind. My first impression of the fandom was I believe there was a situation where people, I hadn't even been announced yet, but like the fandom is so dedicated that like Daniil followed me on Instagram and I hadn't even been announced. Like, no, I had just been cast and she followed me, and right away I just got a stream of follows from just like a bunch of people, and they were like, we know it's you, we know. And I'm just like, gosh, whoa. And it's insane, but then also what came with that was just the outpouring of excitement and love. So like, that was just so cool and exciting. So that was my first little impression, but since then, it's been nothing but lovely, incredible. The dedication that you all have to this, as much as it inspires me to be dedicated and to want to serve the story as best as I can. So it's because of y'all that like, we're really pushing and we're really trying to create an awesome story and do it justice, so yeah. Thank you.
You can ask your question.
Yeah, okay. It's a question for you, Rob.
Hi.
I wanted to say to you that I really love the podcast. There's something that you didn't know and you were surprised to know that amazed you that you didn't know about the show.
I feel like I've learned a lot about the show. I mean, first of all, just having watched it from the beginning for the first time, I'm really just getting to see in real time how great the show is and how great it looks. I really appreciate so much more what was put into the look of the show. Billy Moran, everybody. I think Jensen told some pretty great stories I hadn't heard before. I think it's the episode when Sam's girlfriend dies in season one. She gets on fire on the ceiling and they almost, like, they started a real fire. And the boys like literally had to escape a real burning home. And the director was like, you're good, come on. It's like, but they would never do that today. But like, there was a real burning home. But it's been great. I've learned so much and really been great to put into context things that I've talked about but not really known, like the Bugs episode and things like that, you know.
It's been way too long since I've been in your company, and the people that just sat in my meet and greet that didn't get to ask one single question. I had to deal with 50 minutes of Matt rambling nonstop. I couldn't shut up my face. Like, I told my wife when I was leaving to get on the airplane, I was like, this is about to be 3 years of therapy unloaded on these people. They don't even know what's about to happen to them. Like, I have things I need to get off my chest. And it started strong. There's been a depression building in me, something I could deal with, but as soon as I got here, I was tired. I went up to the hotel room, I took a shower, I looked, put gel in my hair, and I go, here we go. Like, I'm gonna go downstairs, I'm gonna see my friends, we're all gonna be tired, we're all gonna make memories, and this is what I've been missing. And I'm just so fucking glad to be back in this chaos.
We're happy you're back, and you know. He said that backstage, he was like, you know, this is, you really miss it when you don't have it in your life, and I can see that, you know. Certainly my kids don't care. They don't care what I've been on. I feel the same way, and you know, it's been weird not having you at the Creation Awards. Like, I feel like there's a big loss. And Saturday Night Special, not the same without you. Oh, you set the tone of that show. He'd always come on and do like the third song, the first guest, and he'd do a high energy thing. He'd come on, he'd be like, come on, everybody, get everybody going. And I miss that. I miss that a lot.
And that's another thing that changed my life, was you guys forcing me to do that, to be part of it. And I feel now that I've lost some of it. So, like, I'm anxious to be back with you and try it again. Do I still have it? Do I still have the guts to...
Yes, you do.
Get after it on stage! It's been a long time. You forget. You can get lost. Like, sorry, I'm going to spit on you.
I was hoping. Never washing this shirt.
It's been too long, folks. I'm happy to be back. I'll shut up about it now. We're excited.
I'm giving the this signal, so I think I gotta go.
No.
And you're gonna stay on, yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, Robbie B.
Thank you.
Matt, come on. We'll take your question. How about that? So you don't have to stay standing.
Basically just saying, thank God we got the king of karaoke back.
Hey! I love that you stood up just to say that. You mean the world to me, and now I feel like I have to get that tattoo, the karaoke, on the back of my leg somewhere.
I have a two-part question. One is, I was wondering if you've met Drake yet and what you thought of this John Winchester. And then I was also wondering about how you coped without taking your shirt off in front of a big crowd and screaming. We certainly miss him.
I just met Drake briefly. Boy, oh boy, is he handsome. He's strikingly handsome, he seems super kind, and I only got to eat lunch with him for like 10 minutes, and then he had to take off, but I told him, I was like, we have to sit down, there's lots of things for you and I to talk about, so that will happen. I think he's spectacular. I've seen,
so sweet.
Yeah, and I've seen a couple episodes of the show, and I'm proud of the honor that they're doing, and I like the changes that they're bringing in. I think Jensen and the team there are doing a great job, so I hope to get to know him better because, hey, we're the same person, kind of. And listen, his abs might be better, he's a little taller than me, he's cuter, he's got those Jensen lips. I mean, that's all I need is another Winchester boy to be obsessed with their beautiful lips, you know? Enough is enough. It's outrageous. And your second question was that you want me to take my shirt off. I just got here. Give me a few minutes to warm up, all right? Let me go backstage and do some push-ups first, you know?
So I just met my autograph to you very briefly to talk about the Hollywood show.
Yes.
So Mario, I would love to know a little bit about your experience on the set. And if you could pick any TV show or movie for them to make a parody of, what would be and who would you want to play?
I've already pitched The Boys and I want to be fucking Butcher. That being said, does everybody know about the Hollywood girls and what they do? They called me and asked me if I would do one of the characters from Umbrella Academy. Which is a fantastic show, and I did. I played this character, and I grew a funny mustache, and it was very like Captain Jack Sparrow. It was like all the characters that Hollywood will never let me play, because Hollywood's only seen me one way for the last 15 years, and unfortunately, it's like the boy next door with no shirt on. But so many props to the Hollywood girls on their ability to parody something and raise the bar while they do it, which is extremely hard not to just parody something and make it silly and stupid, you know? They raise the bar of whatever they're copying, and it's tremendous. Yeah!
You know, the last time I was here, I didn't have
The only reason I have kids is because of him. And before you ask,
it's not possible.
Ours. As liberal as we are, that's still not a possibility. You know, but Matt introduced me to my wife.
The best fucking thing I've ever done with my life, other than meet my wife and have a baby, was introduce this man to one of the baddest chicks I've ever met in my life, and they made people!
Yeah. We didn't make one person. Oh no, God has too much of a sense of humor. We had two for the price of one. So basically what happened was I was at home in LA and
I think they know how it happens.
And then Haley, no seriously, it happened in South Africa. But that's a different story. We'll get into that in a minute. No, what happened first and foremost, I got a text from Matt and he was like, hey, dude, you're Irish. Yeah. And he goes, so I have this friend, I work with her, and she's going to Ireland, and is there any tips you can give her? And I text back, because I'm an asshole, I said, is she hot? And he goes, do not fuck her. Are there kids in this room? I'm sorry.
How we text back and forth.
He goes, do not fuck her, you've got to promise me. And I said, no, of course not. So a couple of months later,
let me just pause for one second. The reason I text him that, not because I care what he does in the bedroom whatsoever, but I love this woman. This is my co-star on a show. She's somebody I care deeply about. We had a real talk. She's a friend of mine. And also, I met this guy and fell in love with him also. So when you have people that are close to you, never put them together unless it happens like
unless it's going to work, yeah. And it was absolutely, Matt was 100% right, because, you know, these things, you know, invariably can blow up in your face. And, and anyway, so it took us, we were dating a couple of months, and I said, I gotta tell Matt, like, you know, this looks like it might go somewhere. So I had to text Matt and said, Matt, remember I said I wouldn't fuck her? Well, we hadn't, of course, we weren't married at that point, but like I intended it. So anyway, long story short, cut to now, and we have 18-month-old twins, and our lives could not be happier. And it's all down to him, and by extension, down to you.
That's right. I gotta leave the stage, and I don't want to give it to
what?
You. I just didn't want to.
I thought you were staying.
No, this is your stage now.
Oh, fuck.
Don't my own? You were about to blow their mind, don't forget.
Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, Adam
Matt Cohen, everybody!
I know that you've moved back to Ireland.
Yeah.
And I was gonna ask you, was there like a specific reason that she's decided to come back?
Oh man,
or
you know.
It's just like, fuck this pandemic in America.
There's a lot of reasons. There's a lot of reasons, and you know, I don't know.
You just missed the accent.
No, I didn't. You know, look, before I had kids, there was no way I was moving back to Ireland. There was no, I didn't have the compulsion or the drive to move back to Ireland. And then my wife went and got pregnant. Like, I mean, what? Which I'll tell you that story. It's quite a good story. Not the beginning, but I'll tell you, like, you know, a couple of 30 seconds into the we were living in LA, and we had moved to West Hollywood, and we were living there, and we went on the march, one of the Black Lives Matter marches, and it was quite intense. We felt good about being there, and then it turned really nasty. And it turned nasty because, not because of any of the people on the march, but because of people who wanted to try and, you know, divert attention to other things and create havoc, and there was a riot, and the police came out, and there were people shot with rubber bullets, and it was just like, I was looking at the scene. This young black girl, who was about maybe 16 or 17, was shot in the leg and shot in the neck with a rubber bullet, and she walked by our house, which is right on the march, like, okay? So
So we had gotten home, the safety, everyone was like scattering, there were thousands of people running away from the police. There was this young girl and she was limping and she'd been shot, and I was afraid to bring her into our house because it's America. So am I gonna get sued if I give her Tylenol or Advil, whatever, paracetamol for her wounds and give her an ice pack? I was afraid. You shouldn't have that fear. I've never had that fear in Ireland. I've never had that fear. If someone rides on your door and they're injured, you take care of them, right? That, and it's just, it's common sense. And I'm not bitching about America. I love, my wife's American. I love America. I love living there. But it just became this kind of, what are we, like, this is not enjoyable. This is, and then there were police on our street and we almost got arrested for not going into our homes when being held at gun, by being pointed guns at by the cops. So I was doing a TV show in Norway at the time, but I was, thank you. And I was going back in, maybe in, this was August, I was going back in October, and I just said, let's just cut this short, let's leave and go back to Ireland. And then we went back, and long story short, eventually Hayley got pregnant, and we had the kids in Ireland, and we just haven't had the compulsion to move back. Now, we spent 5 months of the year in LA last year, because I'm pains to try and keep the family vibe going and keep her parents involved in the grandparents are so important, and it's so important to them, it's their first grandchildren. So I was doing a lot of conventions in America last year as well, so I was trying to keep everyone happy, but I feel safer in Ireland, and I feel safer with my girls in Ireland, and that's especially when I'm away doing something like this. Or having said that, like, I personally, apart from that one day, I've never really felt unsafe in America, and I think that's a point that needs to be made. I never really felt that, like, walking down the street, I'm going to get shot, for example. I think that's a bit ridiculous. But at the same time, when you're a parent, if you can cut out the variables, if you can cut out the possibility of something, and it's easy to do so, you're going to do it. Because it's like, you know, that's one less thing you have to worry about. You.
I have a question for you. Adam.
Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Brianna Buckmaster!
Bulmers, original cider.
Did you know that Drake came on here and thought that that was actual apple juice? What a fucking idiot, hey?
I forgot we were still doing this.
Bless his heart. They were in the green room. I was getting ready to come on stage. Oh, sorry, just snapped my bra for you all. And they cracked open the scotch and they're like, you guys, we waited until 4:30 and then we gave ourselves a round of applause.
Hi, just a really quick question. I was wondering whether you speak Gaelic Irish.
What?
Whether you speak Gaelic Irish.
How old are the kind of Gaelic? All right, I'm going to do all the kind of Gaelic. Can I talk to them? Well, Mr. Freshman, Mr. Freshman. Gahanawa, Gahintak, Erfad. Yeah, I can. And it's like, you know, it's
I didn't know that! Like, wow!
I have a couple of words, but I'm so proud of it, and I hope my kids speak it at some point, because it's just a great little language, and we're very proud of it. Thank you for
that. That's awesome. Thank you for asking him to do that.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's Pete, but I love you all so much. I'm so happy to be back in Rome! Let's blow the roof off tonight at karaoke!
Temperatures rising. Summer is ill. Do you guys like how I don't know any lyrics? All right, assholes. Here we go.
Amazing.
Who said amazing? Shut up. I haven't had anything to drink today. Do you know what sucks is I don't think that these are fancy whiskeys.
Gather round, ye lads and lasses, set ye for a while, and hearken to me marvel tale about.
Oh, it's an Irish jig.
Let's all make our glasses nigh to friends and family gone, and lift our voices in another Irish drinking song. Consumption took me mother and me father got the box. Me brother drank the whiskey till he wound up in a box.
Cheers! Yum. Oh boy, just starting the day off strong. It's gotta be 5 o'clock though, right?
To bring up another painful topic though, Wayward. Obviously still
not familiar.
But I don't know how it has not gone to the convention, but just wondering, are there any like little bits that you knew of like what was planned or anything that you think we would especially like?
There's a few things. So what they do is when they're pitching a TV show and they have a pilot, they have to pitch the arc of the season. And so we got sent by Bobo, who was the showrunner for Wayward Sisters, we were sent the arc of what was going to happen. And I don't remember most of it, but for myself, because I was so excited, I do remember that Donna was going to be turned into a vampire. I know! Which as an actor would have just been so much fun to see like, an evil Donna, or just like a monster Donna, right?
Leather like, trousers all the way.
Leather trousers. But Donna would just put the donut down and just grab a neck, you know? Love that for her. Yeah, Wayward Sisters, that's a funny thing. We talk about it all the time. If you've ever been to a convention in the United States, Kim Rhodes and I do a PJ party, and we are now going to start doing our podcast, the Wayward Podcast, live at the creation shows. We're so excited. We'll still record them and release them as we do, but we'll also be offering live shows because we just love it. And Kim and I, as I'm saying about confidence, Kim and I's friendship is authentic. She is not just my best friend, she is family to me. Yeah, when the spinoff didn't get picked up, I was so shocked. I remember I was here, right?
Yeah, yeah.
At karaoke, and I was just shocked. And not because I was like hurt and like felt betrayed or anything. I just was like, you fucking dum-dums. I was just like, you guys just missed it. Like fish in a barrel, man. And it was super short-sighted. Maybe Wayward Sisters could have saved the CW. I don't know. You know, Kim and I decided to do the podcast right after that didn't get picked up. And the way that network was pushing the spinoff, Wayward Sisters, it was not going to go in a direction that Kim and I would have liked as actors. They are very centered around young people. And some of those young people didn't really want to be in the show. So it just kind of came not what it had started as. It started to evolve away from what we had, and Kim and I would have conversations going, let's just get our foot in, and then we can start to rearrange it back to what it originally was, which is the idea that we had with you all, because it was your idea, not the CW's, that it was gonna be centered around Jody and Donna. And the girls, but not centered on the girls. Yeah, Kim and I were making jokes that the show was looking, it was starting to be written like the girls went out and hunted and Jody and Donna were just at home making soup. We didn't care for that. So, yeah, when it did get picked up, I think that we weren't surprised and we were sad, but also like we just thought they were so dumb and short-sighted. But I think that's about all that I have news-wise. The reason it didn't get picked up had nothing to do with the content, by the way. It had to do with politics, chess moves, shit that were done by suits that had probably never even seen the pilot, you know. You know, well, now we have the Winchesters. Drake and Jojo. Like, the world keeps going, and I embrace it all, and I feel so lucky to still be involved with it in any way that I can.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Anyway, that's it for me. I love you guys. I love you.
Doing the slow roll. It's, did you not know that?
That's not food, Jared.
And that's what Jared lost a tooth. Sorry. I didn't thought you knew.
I didn't get hard.
I'm getting hard. We thought about doing the joke and going like, the flights were delayed. We're here to tell you, but they've been through enough. So we just didn't do it.
Chuck, it's
which one? Which one?
She was looking at me.
She liked my jacket.
She's looking at you, but you're not your.
Yeah.
Oh
my god! Oh my god, you guys. Those all look similar.
Are you like to
that's
weird. Good morning.
That's all weird.
That's as many of you know, Daniela loves her fashion. And unfortunately, she missed the Gucci runway show a couple of days ago. So we decided to bring it to her.
Do it, Nation.
Worst runway show ever.
Y'all like corduroy?
That's two seasons ago. So long. This 7 years has been a long time.
Yeah. Well, for some of us.
True, true. So we got in later than we hoped to yesterday. So we got to bed around like 11 and woke up around 3, so we might say some funny shit today, sorry.
I can't imagine.
Why not? I mean, we ain't wrong.
And I've got 3 kids with me, so I have
don't call us kids.
I don't know whose kids they are, but excited to be here, guys. Thanks for being here with us. This is what, number 12?
So I heard like 11, 7 different numbers.
Because 12.
Someone said 3.
But 11 is coming after 12. Sure, whatever you want. Whatever number you want it to be. That's what we're doing here. Brianna?
Hello.
Calm down.
Take it away.
Shut the fuck up, man. Sleep my life. Night night, everyone.
And we're back.
All right, we're excited for an awesome weekend. Good to see so many faces again this side of the pond. So, can't wait to see. I see some faces. I see y'all.
Thank you for bringing your faces.
Liking the face stuff. Good to be back. Missed y'all. Thank you. And let's get to it.
Let's get to it.
Let's get to it.
Let's get to it. Let's get to it.
expecting guests? Nope. Okay. Hey, all right, some furniture here. Stand there, I'm gonna try and see if you can catch us.
What's that?
These are, for those who are here this morning, these are harder than they look.
Yeah, those are plushies.
Someone's like, yeah, they're gonna throw them into the audience.
Rock candy.
Yeah, so when we throw them into the audience later.
This is nice, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. You can just stare at yourself.
It's you, that's me. Rather not.
Is that what I look like right now? We look ridiculous.
I know. Yeah. Ridiculously good. Howdy, y'all. Buongiorno.
What? Buongiorno. Buongiorno. Whatever. Listen, I say hello, you say hello.
Hello?
That was the question. Hello?
Hello. Awesome to be back.
My favorite is the okay.
Okay.
Okay. No, not okay. Okay.
It sounds like a question. I'm good. Do you need to know where to go? I'm good. Okay. I'm good. Okay. I swear to God, I know this. Down the hall for what? It's gonna be fun. Okay.
Is it in the UK where they say that's all right, or is that just
Australia?
That's right. Australia. That one messes me up.
That's all right.
Because oh, thank you so much. It's all right. I feel like I just put them out. Yeah. So we say it's like that's all right. Like yeah.
They also do the good on you. You're like
that one. I like the good on you. Or no worries. Like that I can.
But also seems like oh. You're like, yeah, we went this morning for a walk on the harbor.
Was like patronizing?
Like, good on you.
Oh, that's good on you. That's like in the South, we've got bless your heart. Which you can insult somebody as much as you want. And if you tie bless your heart on the end of it, it's okay. Be like, you're the dumbest motherfucker I've ever seen in my life. Bless your heart. And then it's okay.
And it's okay.
Yeah, that's okay. All right, now that we've just made all the enemies in the room.
So, for those who don't know, we flew in yesterday, got in yesterday, we had a pretty long layover, we got delayed, and this was my favorite part of the morning. Nice young lady came up and I'm signing something, she said, you know, how are you? I said, I'm good, I'm good. I actually feel awake though, I don't look at it. She goes, oh, I know your face. So then I was trying to open my eyes really wide, and I'm like, until later, but I love you too, wherever you are. You know who. Okay. Okay. Let's go ahead and get some questions. We have some people waiting. Let's start right over here.
Can there ever be a moment where you had to overcome your greatest fear or one of your greatest fears to shoot a scene?
Yeah, I don't think there was ever a greatest fear moment while filming. I mean, we're doing network television, which is pretty tame in the world of TV. I was more uncomfortable doing stuff in The Boys than I was. That one was, you know,
you looked comfortable.
It's cold acting, dear boy. I was not comfortable. I was very nervous in a few of those scenes. Yeah, but that's but as far as Supernatural goes, no, they
have you ever told the story about it never was shot, but about you finally calling Eric and being like, hey, I don't know about...
Oh yeah, I told him there was a few scenes that I was asked to do that I was like, I didn't know I had a line, but you have found my line and I can't cross that line. I have children that may grow up and see this. Yeah, I think there was supposed to be a little bit more revealed when Soldier Boy was revealed for the first time. And then there was supposed to be a little bit more intimacy when Soldier Boy had his fun with the ladies. That being said, it still was...
I have some of the behind the scenes stuff, and I'll post it later.
No pun intended.
I will say the most nervous I ever got on the set of Supernatural for another person was the scene where Sam Winchester gets hit by a car. So it wasn't me, obviously, but when Mike Carpenter, who was my stuntman that day, got hit by a car, they basically, he had short hair, and so they put a bald cap on him, and then they put like just a tiny, tiny, like a thick liquid padding, and then the sand wig.
Like a gel.
Like a gel, like a gel padding. And that's all he had covering his skull, and then he has to get hit by a car, and there's no way to really control it. There's no way, like, okay, I'm gonna jump out this window, and I'm gonna spin once and land in pads. It's like, hey, you're getting hit by a car, like, try not to land on your head when you're flipping and flopping through the air. And so that happened, we watched it, and we were all like, is he gonna get up? And he got up. And then the second time, he, like, his foot got caught on the bumper, and he got dragged, it was, yeah. And then I think he went a third time, and then he got up, and stunt actors and actresses, they're usually like, I'm good. They'll have a broken bone that's obviously broken and be like, we need to do it again? Cool. What? This time he got up and he was like, I'm done. And so we all just kind of clapped. And yeah, that was the most nervous I got for somebody else.
Go back to the boys real quick. There's a scene where I pick up Carl Urban's character, Butcher. He's like, I've knocked him down to the ground, and I come up behind, I grab the back of his collar, and he's face down. And I literally go up and over my body and slam him into a desk. And the stunt guy, obviously it wasn't Carl, but they wired up a stunt guy so that there was a wire. So, because I'm supposed to be super, super strength, right? So one arm just flinging a human body. And they basically, like, as I did this, the wire got pulled. But then at the apex, they just let the wire loose. And so I'm slamming him into as hard as I can. They're not feathering it down. And I remember the first time I did it, I was like, oh, this is gonna feel so cool. And I went, oh gosh. Are you okay? And his name was Brian. He just popped right up. And he's like, yeah, let's do it again. And I'm like, I don't wanna. But we did it. We did it many times, and the guy's a champ. So, that, but yeah, I was really. And then after I got used to it, then I just felt like a beast. Yeah, that was crazy.
And my question is actually, since you're already talking about like really crazy things, what's the stupidest injury you ever got, like on any set?
Wait, how much time you got?
Some.
I probably got a list of. I know we both have a list of. Of these, I'll go with the first one that comes to mind, and it was Wendigo, I think, when I was pulling the gun out of the back of the Impala.
Yeah, was that Hookman?
Oh, it was Hookman. That's right. So very early on, that I was grabbing a long gun, I was grabbing a rifle, and I pulled it from the center of the gun, and the butt of it caught the trunk edge, and the barrel of the gun came up and hit me right square in my eye. So I did it to myself, but of course I was all Dean-like, and I was like, and it split me open. That was pretty stupid, and self-inflicted too, so no one to blame but me.
If you were to attend a convention and meet people like we are doing this weekend, who would a couple of your dream guests to meet be?
I think I'd probably go mostly to musicians, just because, like, Eddie Vedder or something.
Jason and Billy gave the exact same answers on theirs for musicians as well.
Yeah, I think actors bore me. Because I am an actor. Not you. Not you. Not you.
Because I'm not an actor.
Well, I find myself boring, so I feel like the soundtrack to my life is what I would kind of go to.
Yes, I would say I instantly go to musicians as well, although they don't really do conventions like this, per se. It is definitely more of an actor thing to do. That being said, I don't know. I think it'd be kind of cool to sit and hear what... I think Keanu Reeves is an interesting... I'm trying to think of who I would want to listen to answer questions and speak about things involved in the industry. I wouldn't mind sitting in on some of the Marvel, you know, a Downey Jr. And strictly for just kind of curiosity purposes, not like, oh my God, Iron Man. I think he's an interesting fellow who has lots of interesting things to say about topics that I could relate to.
We know you got a few new tattoos over the last 2-3 years. Would you like to talk us through? Be curious.
There's a new one I just got. My pants are on too tight. I haven't gotten anything new in a while. I got this little thumb guy, which I think I've explained was, I was with Jeffrey Dean Morgan. We were at a friend's wedding in Tulsa, Oklahoma. And our wives were doing something with the bride and things, and we had the afternoon free. So naturally, as you do when you're with Jeff, you go for beers and tattoos. He got a few more than I did. I limped in with just one, but that was the story behind that. You got a few more than I had recently.
Yeah, I have a few on the list that I haven't gotten yet. I think probably most recently, so we all know we got the Basquiat crown together with JDM at his wedding. And then the day after Supernatural finished, which was September 11th, 2020, my buddy Bruce and I went to his tattoo artist in Vancouver, and I got this little, it's like a geometric design, it's just a bunch of lines. And I love when people ask me what it is, because they're like, what is that? I'm like, oh, it's an ancient Sumerian. Like, no kidding, what does it mean? And I'm like, iPhone update. So we just literally like went to, it didn't mean anything. We just liked what it said, and we're like how it looked what it said. And then so I kind of did a little dot on him, he did a little dot on me. I have the star under my bicep. I have a come and take it kind of thing, which was really cool because I think a month later, come and take it became, at least in Texas, became like a woman's rights kind of thing, like come and take my rights. So it's kind of like, yeah, badass. And then I have an homage to Dr. Seuss, Other Places You'll Go, and mine is a little different. It's got T for Tom and A for Austin, which is Chef's name, and there's a little moon for Odette. But yeah, there's more. Do you have some?
Yeah, I got two. I got this famous one, and I got one for my favorite band.
Awesome. What's the famous one, and what's the band?
Your AKF.
Oh, amazing.
And this is the band called Aha. It's an
old
band.
I know Aha.
They're my favorite, and so I got an album artwork on my own.
Very cool. I think he and I both tried to hit the high note from Take On Me.
Tried.
We both tried and failed.
Thank you.
Awesome. Yeah, that's it. Thank you so much.
I'm Amy from the Netherlands, me and my partner go to a lot of costume events, and I've heard...
Custom events?
Costume events. And I've heard Jensen and you talk about going to like Ren Fairs with your family. And I've seen Jensen cosplay as Batman and Red Hood. And I was wondering if you ever go to Comic-Con, or maybe you're ready for you to dress up, maybe incognito like Adam Savage does, what would you dress up as?
You know, I've already got the Red Hood and the Batman outfits, so I'm going to feel like those would probably be my go-to. Besides those,
Bullwinkle?
Yeah, Rocky Bullwinkle.
Yeah, I think we'd do well. Boba Fett? I like something with a mask. Just I like the experience of being around people who are all passionate about stuff and not being flavored by like, aren't you that guy who was on Gilmore Girls? And that's it. Yeah.
It goes the screen character, because that just seems very comfortable.
Yeah, that's right. I did that one where I went and sat in Paula.
That's right. Who do you like to, or is there a genre that you like the best?
Well, I used to go to like Victorian events.
Uh-huh.
Like Victoria's Secret? You don't have to tell us, you can keep it a secret.
You can keep a Victorian secret.
Yeah. Like Victorian balls.
Yes.
That's a big secret.
Have you seen his Victorian? We didn't sleep a lot.
And Jared's back. I told myself I wouldn't start this early. So.
Victorian balls. I mean, I like balls. I like secrets.
If you want to experience one, it's actually a Victorian wedding, which is mine next year. If you want to come.
No way! That's awesome. Is everybody getting dressed up?
Yes, every guest should be dressed up.
Is Victorian?
Yeah, it's in a big castle in Belgium. No lingerie, Jared.
I don't know. I'm cosplaying. That's Victoria Beckham. Balls. Stop the balls.
Because never mind.
I'm going to put this away. Well, a happy early wedding. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Blow up costumes. So my feet would be balls, and it would be like.